Blackstone Audio presents Kali's Kiss by John Dodds. This book is read by Robin Sachs. Chapter 1. In the pre-dawn quiet before the city of Glasgow had properly woken up, Elizabeth Bell could hear the soft crunch of frosted grass beneath her feet as she pounded her circuit through Kelvin Grove Park. She liked to dodge off the walkway and run between the trees. In summer, she sometimes took off her trainers and ran barefoot until she reached the flight of steps leading uphill to street level and the last mile home. Her breath condensed in sparkling motes, such was the depth of cold. Her skin prickled and burned with it. Still, she had decided spring was on the way, so opted to wear a t-shirt. As far as she was concerned, it was spring, even though the weather forecast insisted otherwise. Her peripheral vision discerned shadows sliding against the bole of an ancient oak tree. A bit early for cottaging, she thought, and increased her pace. Besides which, this part of the park wasn't known as a gay pickup area. She gave the tree a wide berth, but as she left it behind, she had the sensation of being watched. God, not again, she thought. It had been 5 years, and she was sure she'd got over it by now. Her psychiatrist had agreed, though he had invited her to come back to see him if any of the old feelings returned. No, she chided herself. I'm not going to let that happen. So she ran faster still until her chest started to tighten with the extra exertion. The wheezing began quietly. If she continued in this way, it would only get harder to take a full breath. Plus, there was the danger of panicking, of over-breathing. Slow down, she told herself, visualizing her breathing becoming more relaxed. Breathing in through her nose and out through her mouth was becoming an effort. Already she'd hit the 9-mile wall and hadn't yet broken through it. The young Elizabeth had been the asthmatic girl at secondary school who forced herself to take on all the athletic challenges that came her way, refusing to be excused from gym or orienteering on the grounds of ill health. She wasn't disabled, after all. Once or twice she had pushed herself over the limit, luckily with a friend or teacher nearby who were able to take her to the school nurse for the salbutamol inhaler. Over the years, her condition had improved, thanks to employing the Buteyko breath control method. But it didn't always work, given that whenever she ran, she would always, at some point, break the rules. Elizabeth still felt annoyed that Williams had declined her application for a lecture tour in the States. She rarely got the chance to travel on work-related business. As a mere senior lecturer, she usually had to step aside for the director to exercise his prerogative to net the juicy gigs. But her boss hadn't counted on Elizabeth's best-selling book on social anthropology. Simon Williams didn't believe his deputy could fill his substantial shoes on the glory circuit, and therefore expressed indifference, and sometimes open disapproval, towards her book. Too populist, he claimed. She was, and should consider herself above all, an academic. The book's subject was death cults, social engineering of primitive peoples by religious cults that distorted core beliefs for political ends and to accrue power. It had caught the popular imagination. Being published in 1995, not long after the Rwandan genocide by extremist Hutu militia, helped raise the book's profile. This, along with the fact that Elizabeth wrote with a novelist's skill and a book tour, allowed reluctantly on the basis of unpaid leave that attracted large audiences, put it high on the bestsellers list. Naturally, none of this enamored her to Williams. The work of academics was not to be sullied by pandering to the masses, he might have argued. The fact that his own two books on tribalism and migration patterns of Oriental peoples over the past 500 years had sunk without a trace was neither here nor there, apparently. Nor that his third manuscript had been rejected by 5 publishing houses to date. Something made her check behind her. There were presences.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.